Joel Estes, as with most folks, headed up into the mountains to get rich on gold, yay gold, and didn't really find a lot, so he, his wife, and his 13 children decided they would turn their attention to farming. That didn't really work too well either. Very hard to farm in the short growing season in that part of the world. In the early 1860s, William Newton Byers of the Rocky Mountain newspaper came to visit, and because Joel Estes was in the area and hosted him and showed him around and such, he named the area Estes Park, smelling like real cowboys and cowgirls there at the McGregor Ranch. Another name that you might recognize is the Earl of Dunraven. He came to the valley and totally loved it and wanted to buy the whole thing. And he actually was pretty close to succeeding, in which case we might not be visiting today if he had had his way, turning it into his own little private fiefdom. Fortunately, season, of course, summertime, and then the low season the rest of the year. Here's the sign, by the way, the official one where you get your picture on our right. So we are still in high season now. It usually runs into October sometime.
This is not a natural lake.
This is a constructed lake for flood control, recreation, and hydroelectric power. So here are the fairgrounds to our left, ladies and gentlemen. So if you have not yet come to the Scottish Festival, you're going to have to wait till September of next year. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick spin by the Stanley Hotel here. I was requested to give you a closer look. Now, having been to the Lizzie Borden Bed and Breakfast, the Stanley Hotel, of course, more than 100 years old, is famous for two things, and we're just going in, taking a spin, and coming right back out again. Number one, of course, its beauty, its view. I mean, look to the left. What a great view of Long's Peak you have over there. That squarish mountain with the notch on the left. What a fine view. And you understand why F.O. Stanley came up here and just fell in love. The other is something that I have never experienced, and that is the scary side. I don't read or watch scary. I don't do that. Stephen King's book, The Shining, is, as I understand it, set here. And although I've never done this, I've never stayed at the Stanley, I have toured the Stanley, but apparently on the television, they have a channel that is devoted to that movie, and you may watch it 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
I'm gonna take Highway 7 here.
It was opened in 1918 and is the state's oldest scenic byway. And as we pull onto Highway 7 here, ladies and gentlemen, you are on the peak-to-peak highway. So,
ta-da!
Ta-da! Okay, I know you feel it, right? Okay, you feel it in all of your tender vittles. So, now Mr. Biggers, who wrote The Seven Keys to Bald Pate, actually came to this inn, which was opened by the Maces, and he said, this is exactly what I had in mind, and so he said in his imagination, the Bald Pate Inn had become the actual Bald Pate Inn. Now in the book, seven people go to the Bald Pate Inn, each with a key, thinking that he or she is going to be the only person there, only to find it's practically a convention of folks. And of course, mystery, murder, and mayhem ensue. All the while, Mr. McGee is trying to get this beautiful blonde. It's a happy ending in the final quotient. when the inn opened, the owners originally gave keys for folks to take home as souvenirs. When World War I happened and metal prices sort of went out the roof, they stopped. Folks who liked this tradition were so sad that they started sending keys to the Bald Pate. This was the beginning of a key collection which now numbers in excess of 20,000 keys. And I wrote down some of the places represented. The Pentagon, Westminster Abbey, Mozart's wine cellar, Frankenstein's castle, even keys that belonged to Adolf Hitler. A stop at the Bald Pate is coming up shortly. Now, ladies and gentlemen, there is no elevator at the Bald Pate Inn. They have a walkway and they have stairs. If you want to go up to the main level where the keys are, you must either take the walkway or the stairs. Jamie's going to drop us off and then head back down. We're going to have about 10 minutes, 15 minutes or so to look at the keys, and then we'll continue. Now, we're not eating here today. I'm assuming you've already eaten, but they do have a very nice restaurant here. And if you'd like, at some point in the future, if you haven't already tried, you should come back and give it a go. Ladies and gentlemen, coming up in just a moment, the crickety, creaky, but always interesting, Bald Pate Inn. Okay, here's our ramp. Yay! It's much easier when there aren't a zillion cars parked here. So ladies and gentlemen, our ramp is just here to the right. For most folks, recently, in 1993, when Pope John Paul II came to Colorado for World Youth Day, he did come to this chapel. He actually did some hiking, and for a while, there was a trail known as Pope John Paul II Trail. Unfortunately, the flooding of 2 years ago did a real devil of a job on that trail, as well as the landscaping around the chapel. The chapel's coming up here in just a moment on our right, ladies and gentlemen. It is open for tours. We are not touring today, but it is. So here it is on our right, ladies and gentlemen. It's not a huge building.
but a very nice one. Unfortunately, in 2011, they had a very devastating fire in some of their outbuildings. And then this flood, 2013, all of the landscaping around the building was pretty much scoured away completely. And as you see, they really have not come back from it. As I understand it,
And set against the blue sky, I mean, really, how can you complain, right? So, this is why we live in Colorado, right? That and the good-looking, effervescent tour guides. But
do we meet them?
You meet them on future tours. Unfortunately, you got me today. Fort Boulder, especially after the Barker Reservoir was begun in 1910, as a very nice amenity for the city. I wasn't around to see this, but I'm told that in the 1960s, a lot of folks who didn't want to participate in society fled up into the hills and settled in communes or whatever with their fellows. And sort of checked out. And I was told that Netherlands was one of the destinations for folks who wanted to get away from the world. So this sort of hippie influx did lend some vitality to Netherlands. Today it's a tourist town with a number of folks living in it as well, so it's going fine. The main reason you should go to Netherlands in March, of course, would be Frozen Dead Guy Days. Now they call him Dead Ned, but that's not his actual name. Brito Morse. This is the city of Ward, ladies and gentlemen, just over 9,200 feet. Thank you. reason we're stopping is for that final bathroom break and for those who wish to ride the Carousel of Happiness, which this gentleman hand-carved all those animals and other figures over 20 plus years. That money does support historic preservation and other historic ventures in Colorado. So the State Historical Society preservation of buildings across the state are at least in part funded by your...
Riding a Carousel of Happiness. Happy birthday, Mom.
Thank you. It's a good birthday.
Stay on there.